Okay, welcome back, everyone. A good discussion about the various kinds of prayers. And there's a question in our chat where Deeksha is asking us, when Jesus knew why God sent him on the earth, why did he pray like prayer of supplication? Okay. Why did he pray a prayer of supplication? So, Deeksha, just to clarify, are you asking about the Garden of Gethsemane or generally praying a prayer of supplication? Specific. Okay, fine. So, why did Jesus pray? See, we have to understand, as I told in the last class, Jesus was fully God and he was fully man. So, as a man, he would have also undergone emotional turmoil or emotional difficulty, pressure, when he knew that he has to face the cross, which means that he will be beaten, he will be forsaken, he will be put to shame. It's not easy to go through all that. And along with that, he also, when he is on the cross, he would have realized that the sins of the world will be put on him. You know what God doesn't like? God doesn't like sin. So, if something has sin, that will be separated from the Father. And he knew that for a moment, the sins of the world will he has to carry so that he can pay the price for it. You remember on the cross, he says, "Father, why have you forsaken me?" How can the Father forsake the Son? Never, never the Father can forsake the Son, because the relationship that the Father has with the Son is so strong. But in that moment, because of the sin of the world, there is a separation that Jesus has to experience with the Father, which he doesn't like. He knows all this is going to happen. So you can imagine, he's going through a lot of pain within him. He's going through a lot of pain in his emotions. So as a person, like a normal human being, when we go through difficult times, even we say, right, that, oh, I don't want to go through this. If there's any way that you can change it, God, please change it. So it's just the humanity of Jesus that we can see in his prayer of supplication. But thank God that he prayed a prayer of consecration, even though he was struggling. Okay, so I hope I have answered your question. You understood. Okay, great. Right, thank you for that question, Deeksha. Really good question. And I just wanted to go back to Blessy's question from last class. You asked the will that God has given us, right? Like God gave us free will. What are some verses that we could look at for free will? So, Blessy, if you go back to the book of Genesis, there itself, there are many examples for, like, when God created Adam and he did not find a suitable partner for Adam, what did he say? He said, you go name all the creatures and you can select a suitable partner. So, what does that mean? There is free will. It's not like God said, okay, you just, I am telling you, and this is how. So you see the demonstration of free will in that example. You also see the demonstration when, in the book of Genesis, when God says, this is the tree of good and evil, the tree of life, don't eat it. See, if there was no free will, God would have created man like a robot and said, I have programmed you. You cannot touch this tree. But he told him it exists and you make a choice, isn't it? And even later on, when we look at so many different passages and lives of people in the Bible, there was always a choice. Even Joshua 24 verse 15, where he says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. But that passage starts with him saying, you choose this day, whom do you want to follow? He's telling the people, it's a choice. If you want to choose to live for God, you choose. If you don't want to choose, it's up to you. So God has given us free will. He will never, you know, impose it. Now, if you look at the Psalms, there are passages where the psalmist says, you know, I will bless the Lord at all times. So when we say, I will, what is the meaning? I can also say, I won't. There is a choice. So when we are exercising the capacity of will, it simply shows that God allows us to make choices. He will tell us what is the right path, but he'll never push us and say, you have to. He doesn't do that. He says, look, I'm telling you, these are the instructions. This is the truth of God's word. It's up to you. You choose. Choose this day whom you will follow. So these are all some examples. I hope it is clear. And the ultimate one would be salvation. Because Jesus died on the cross. But today all of us have a choice. There are so many people, even though they have heard the gospel, they haven't responded or accepted. But God does not really, thrust it on them or force it on them. Okay, so there is the exercise of free will. So just some examples. All right, so let's get back to our subject here. We are looking at the different kinds of prayers. Next is the prayer of agreement. Okay. As I said earlier, when I talked about intercession, that though God has created us as individuals, there's something about the body of Christ. What is the body of Christ? When we study passages like Romans 12, we see that there are functions, different functions that God gives each one of us. So we are a body. Some of us may have a function in administration. Some of us may have a function in teaching. Some of us may have a function in leadership. Some may have a function in helps. So as you look at the capacities that God has given each one of us, we're all supposed to help each other, work together. That is why we are called as a body. Now imagine if I as a body, if my hands don't like my feet, and you know, my feet come at 9 a.m. for the class and the hands are like, no, I'll see you at 10 a.m. It'll be crazy. And it's just not how we work. Unless I support myself, right? My whole being, I cannot show up here at 9 a.m. So in the same way, we are all the body of Christ and we need to work together. We need to serve together, right? And we need to support one another. So we talked about intercession, where we pray for others. Now we can even pray for unbelievers, because remember we said that prayer is exercising our dominion, releasing our authority. So I can even pray for an unbeliever and they may get healed, receive a miracle in their lives. Now the next aspect of working together in prayer is the prayer of agreement. Okay, so there are times when we may need at least one more person to agree with us in prayer. Now, does this mean that if I pray and there is nobody with me, that prayer is less powerful? What do you think? Again, it's like blur for me. There's no yes, there's no, there's no, I'm not sure. So, is a prayer which is prayed individually less powerful than a prayer of agreement? No, okay, I heard no. Okay, yes, Akhil? More effective. Okay, sure. So, see, it's not about more or less. It's about the appropriate prayer for the situation. Okay, now, what if I don't have anybody to agree with me? Okay, suppose I'm traveling alone and there's nobody with me and I'm in need. I have to pray. I don't even have a phone. What do? I pray. But does it mean my prayer is less effective? No. God wouldn't consider it that way. But the point is, there are some times where the right kind of prayer is a prayer of agreement, or the appropriate prayer for the moment is a prayer of agreement. So in those times, it's better to do a prayer of agreement. Okay, is that fine? So it's not less or more, better or, you know, worse. Now let's look at a passage, Matthew chapter 18 and verse 19. Matthew chapter 18 and verse 19. I want to request another person to please go ahead and read. Someone else. Okay. Matthew 18 and verse 19.
Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven.
Okay, Sabita, did you read Matthew 18 and verse 19? Yeah, just check the number. Matthew 18 and verse 19. Yeah, you can go to that verse and reread it for us again.
Against I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven.
Wow. Okay. So that is telling us about agreeing together in prayer. So what does it say? It says, if any two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. So any two of you agree touching one thing, how many people do we need to agree? 5,000?
No, one.
12? If you speak loudly, I can hear you. I can't hear you.
With one accord.
Two people. Okay. We need only
the woman and Mary and with his brother.
Okay. Sorry about that. I think somebody's just muted. So only two people. Jesus is giving us a great opportunity for any two people to agree on one thing. So if there is a matter which is in the will of God and any two people agree, it's Jesus said that the Father will do it for us, isn't it? So we can use the power of agreement when it comes to prayer. Now, when you look at the book of Acts, okay, you're all familiar, right? The book of Acts, when the disciples, Jesus went back up into heaven, and then the disciples were the ones who carried on the ministry in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and the surrounding regions. At that time, in the initial passages, you see this term which says one accord, and the believers, the disciples, were in one accord. What is one accord? One accord is oneness of heart, oneness of mind. So they were together and they were in agreement. So when they agreed and prayed, so many amazing things happened in the lives of the believers. So praying together, we need a minimum of two people, but the maximum can be any number of people. Coming together and praying, it is extremely powerful. So we need the Holy Spirit to guide us in which prayers we need to agree with someone, okay, and pray together with them. So I just want to share one small testimony. This is regarding a person that I know who was going through a health problem, okay, and their report was quite like it stated a pretty serious condition. So this one auntie, she called me up and she said that her family member, they've gone to the hospital and the report says, okay, a certain condition. So please pray. They're doing all the tests and everything, and we really don't want this person to have that particular condition. So I don't know how, but in that moment, I felt, I just picked the call. I was in office. So it's not like I can be with them because I'm in office, they are in the hospital. So I just prayed and I said, Holy Spirit, what should I do? What should I say? Should I give them a scripture? Should I pray for them on the phone? What should I do? I don't know, because it's quite tough to hear news like this. So in that moment, I just felt like pray a prayer of agreement. So I asked her, Auntie, I'm sorry to hear this report, but if you have some time, can we both agree together and pray that this condition, that God will heal? So that was my intention, healing for that condition. But when I started to pray, the words came from my mouth, which I never planned. The words came, I'm sure it's the Holy Spirit guiding us. I just said, Lord, we command this condition to change. The report will change in the name of Jesus. I just said something like that, not because I wanted to, but I just felt impressed to say it. And I said it. After I finished the prayer, I thought, what did I pray? How can the report change? No? What will they think about me? But anyway, I had already prayed the prayer and we kept the phone. But the most amazing thing is, in a couple of days, that auntie called me back and she said, the report has changed. We don't know what happened, whether they gave us a wrong report in the first go or whether something has changed in the person's, physical condition. But whatever I told you, that name, he doesn't have that. So the report is saying he has something else, which is, a less sort of a milder issue. But that was a big, a learning for me, a lesson for me, that we have to go as the Holy Spirit guides us. Sometimes just two people, maybe your family member is with you, or those who are married, just your husband and wife. So that is the reason it's so powerful when people are in agreement. Even a husband and wife, a couple, they just pray together in agreement and say, God, this is what we want for the family, for the home, for the church. It's really powerful. Right? And God is saying, if any two of you, agree touching one thing, then my Father in heaven will do it for you. Okay? So think about these things. God is already, He's giving us the keys and He's saying, you can have an effective prayer life in this way. You can also pray prayers of agreement. So in small groups, when we just pray for each other, I know we have intercession prayer every day when we close off, right? Don't just take it as a time when it's in the timetable, we have to pray, okay, let's pray. No, you're agreeing with somebody. That's very powerful. Agree and pray. You'll see things happen in that particular situation. Now, if more than two, our church services, where we have so many people, they all gather together, or if we have some events in the city where different churches come together and we are praying, God, we are praying for revival, we are praying for the city to change, for the city to be transformed, we are praying for the government. What happens? We're all praying with one heart, like the book of Acts, one accord. Then it'll be so powerful and God can move powerfully on our behalf. So we have to look at the situation, the context, and then apply the prayer. Then it will be effective. Okay, so let's move on. We will carry on here. We'll go to the next kind of prayer, which is prayer in the Spirit. We have an entire chapter about prayer in the Spirit, but now I'll share in short about prayer in the Spirit. Prayer in the Spirit is also known as praying in tongues. Okay, so what is this kind of prayer? We observe prayer in the Spirit for the first time in the book of Acts, when people were filled with the Holy Spirit. They were baptized with the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, one thing that happened is they started speaking a language which they could not understand. Okay, and we read further in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 about what this language is all about. So in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 2, Paul writes, when one speaks in an unknown tongue, we speak mysteries unto God. We speak mysteries unto God. So what are these mysteries that we are speaking to God when we pray in tongues? We don't know. Because we cannot understand. Right? So when one prays in tongues, the Bible tells us that our brain cannot understand the language which we are speaking. Who are we speaking to? We are speaking to God. Because Paul wrote that. Paul said, we speak mysteries unto God. We are directly speaking to God when we pray in tongues. We are praying things that we cannot understand. Okay? And these are mysteries. Or in other words, if you understand mystery, the unknown. It's unknown to us. But is anything unknown to God? Is anything unknown to God? He's an all-knowing God. So when we say we speak mysteries unto God, it simply means that what I am saying is a mystery for me, but it is not a mystery for God. God knows what I am speaking, right? God knows what I am praying. And the Bible also tells us that we pray as the Spirit gives us utterance in Romans 8, verse 26, 27. So the prayers that we pray in tongues are prayers which are inspired by the Holy Spirit. And they are prayers which are in the will of God. So when we pray in tongues, it is very, very, very powerful. Because one, we are speaking to God. Second, we are praying in the will of God. Sometimes when we pray in our own language, we may say things that we understand. Things like, God, I want this, I don't want that, or this is my preference, something else is not my preference. It's limited. My understanding is very limited because I have knowledge of the past. I may have knowledge, from books and information, a little bit to kind of consider my future. That's all. My capacity is limited. But when I pray in tongues, I can pray according to God's mind. He knows everything. And what does the Bible say? We pray as the Spirit gives us utterance. So the Holy Spirit is inspiring certain prayers which are way beyond my thinking. Now, what am I praying for? I could be praying for my future. I could be praying for my ministry. I could be praying for a country. I could be praying for another person who's going through a crisis right now. So many things that I could be praying for in the Spirit, but I have no idea because my finite human brain does not have the capacity to even think that far. But the Holy Spirit helps us, gives us the utterance to pray these prayers unto God, and we speak mysteries unto God. Okay? And these are prayers in the will of God, meaning every prayer which we pray in the Spirit is 100% in the will of God because it doesn't belong to us. Those prayers are coming from the Holy Spirit. Right? So, praying in tongues is a very, very, very crucial prayer which every believer must engage in. And I will talk about it when we go to the subject or the lesson on praying in the Spirit. But just in short, I want us to know that in our prayer times, this category of praying is something that we must include. So we can pray in our language, but when we pray in our language, we're only praying according to our brain's capacity. But when we pray in the Spirit, we are praying the mind of God, and the mind of God knows everything, right? So imagine God is giving us both these options. Even Paul says, I pray in the Spirit, I pray with my understanding. We can pray both. Include praying in tongues. When we practice it, we will understand the value of praying, what praying in tongues is. And so many people that I have spoken to, I have listened to, men of God, women of God, some of them, some revivalists whose pictures that you see over here, many of them have these testimonies. They used to pray hours together in the Spirit, right? So no wonder God was able to release a mighty move of the Holy Spirit during their times. Okay, so praying in the Holy Spirit, in other words, praying in tongues is a very powerful way in which we can engage in prayer with God. So practice it, and we'll talk more about it later on. If any questions are there, please do ask. I can see a question here in the chat where Blessy says, praying in spirit, does it only mean praying in tongues? We cannot pray in spirit without tongues. Okay. Blessy, the way we understand this is, we have to go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Okay, in that passage, you have two scriptures, verse 14, verse 15, where Paul says, I pray in the spirit, and I also pray with my understanding. And he also says, I sing in the spirit, and I also sing with my understanding. So, what is Paul trying to say? If praying in the spirit was praying with the understanding. Praying with understanding is praying with my knowledge, my language. Now, if Paul wanted to just say praying in your language or praying stronger, praying in the spirit, meaning you're just praying a very intense prayer, strong prayer, why did he make that division? He could have just said praying in with understanding. Both are praying in understanding, right? But he is only separating it. And he's saying, I pray in the spirit and I also pray with my understanding, which means praying with my understanding is different, praying in our own language. But praying in the spirit is praying without understanding, which means, which is the only way we pray without understanding? Tongues. Because we don't know what we are praying. So because Paul makes that distinction and he makes it twice, I pray with the spirit, I pray with my understanding. I sing with the spirit. I sing with my understanding. It's quite clear that whenever this term praying in the spirit is used, he's talking about tongues. Yeah? And there's so much more he writes about tongues in that passage. 1 Corinthians 14. You can actually go and read it. Okay? I hope it's clear. But if you have any more questions, you can always ask. Okay. So that is about praying in the spirit. Everyone okay? Or you have certain clarifications about this category of prayer? Online students, please feel free to ask. Okay. Okay, Shekhar, you're saying verse speak is speaking in tongues. I'm sorry, I didn't get you. Could you please come again? But it is really praying in tongues. Is it really praying in tongues? Verse speak is speaking in tongues. Okay, I'm not quite clear, Shekhar. If you could kindly rephrase it for me, I would be able to answer that question. Speak. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I am getting it now. So, 1 Corinthians. Yeah. So 1 Corinthians 14 verse 2, for he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God. For no one understands him. However, in the spirit, he speaks mysteries. Okay. So Shekhar, your question is about the word speak. Okay, the word speak. Yeah, so as we said earlier, prayer is anyway communion with God. So it's not just asking God for something, it is speaking to God. So even if we say speaking in tongues, automatically it means prayer. I hope that makes sense. Yeah, sure. Thank you. All right. Yes, please. Okay, so you're saying you You were trying to copy tongues? Okay, fine. So meaning what you're saying is you've heard people pray in tongues, so you are trying to pray like that. Yeah? But have you ever prayed in tongues yourself? It has already come? Okay, it has already come. Now, so the point is, Aman, this language comes from the Holy Spirit. As the Spirit gives utterance, okay, let me just give you that verse. We'll go to Romans chapter 8. Okay, I'll read it for us. Romans 8, verse 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Verse 27. Now, He who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because He makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. So notice both the scriptures, it says Spirit Himself makes intercession, and then next verse, He makes intercession. Okay, so my point is, though we are speaking the words have to come from the Holy Spirit. So if I am trying to copy, or a better word is imitate, if I'm trying to imitate people who speak in tongues and I try to imitate their language, who is that language coming from? It's coming from me. Then it is not tongues. So we cannot imitate. Or we can also put it this way, tongues cannot be manufactured. We can't create it. Because it doesn't come from human beings. Both the verses here, Romans 8, 26, 27, it says, the Spirit Himself makes intercession. He makes intercession. So, whatever is coming from the Holy Spirit is what we have to speak. Now, it is true that if we are baptized in the Holy Spirit and we are starting to speak in tongues, we may not speak huge languages or different words. Sometimes we ourselves notice that the words are repetition. You're saying the same thing again and again and again, but you don't worry about it because it's for God to understand. So He knows what it means. We may say the same words, but we may be praying very different prayers each time to the Father. Okay, so don't copy or imitate another person's language. If we do that, the prayer is not starting from the Holy Spirit. It starts from us, and that's incorrect. Okay, it clarifies, right? Okay, great. Thank you. Let's move on. Yes, Akhil. I couldn't hear you very well. Yes. Okay, so those who do not pray in tongues yet, do we pray in our own language? Yes, of course. If you've still not received the baptism in the Holy Spirit, you can pray in English. But the point I want to make is, Paul writes to the believers. Okay, 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 1. I'll quickly read that for us. Okay, he says, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Okay, that is verse 1. Now, I will also read for us verse 31. Okay, fine. Anyway, we'll just stop with this. So the point there is, he says desire spiritual gifts. When he says pursue love, to how many people is he saying pursue love? How many believers? What do you think? Just give me an answer. And he's saying, okay, or believers, walk in love. To how many believers is he saying walk in love? To all believers. He's telling every believer, walk in love. That's why we have 1 Corinthians 13. That whole passage is about, you know, love is patient, love is kind, love is, you know, long-suffering, all that. All the believers walk in love. In the same breath or the same sentence, he's saying, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. To how many believers is he saying desire spiritual gifts? All the believers. Right? So here's my point. First is, if we are not able to speak in tongues, we can pray in our language. It's fine. But we are supposed to desire. Meaning, we need to ask God, God, I want it. I want to have it. I want to be able to speak in tongues. I want to be able to speak in an unknown language. Because that is also in the scriptures. Desire spiritual gifts. Okay, and I won't get into it, but there are passages of scripture that tell us that through the spiritual gifts, we can edify the body, meaning build up the people of God using spiritual gifts. So it is God who has given us the spiritual gifts, and we must not say, okay, I don't want spiritual gifts. We want those spiritual gifts. One of those spiritual gifts is tongues. So if we don't have the gift of speaking in tongues, we can begin to desire. And every time we can say, God, I really want it. I need it. I want it. Then what happens? Surely God will give. Because he's telling all the believers, which means all the believers can have all the spiritual gifts. Okay? So I hope it clarifies. Thank you. Thank you so much. Okay, let's continue. Really good questions. Great. Okay. All right. So I think we have a fair understanding about praying in the Spirit. We'll discuss more when we go to the chapter. Now let's move on to the next type of prayer. That is the prayer of repentance or confession. Now there is a need for us to repent before God. When we have sinned against him, even when it comes to our salvation, you know, when we accept Christ into our lives, how do we, you know, turn around? If we go back to the first sermon that Apostle Peter preached in Acts chapter 2, he talks about Jesus being the Messiah. And then the people ask him, so what should we do? What should we do that we hear about Jesus being the Messiah? He says, repent. Repent and be baptized. So, repentance is turning away from our sinful ways and turning towards God. Okay? So, if you want to understand it in a like a simple manner, it is when we drive, we make a U-turn, isn't it? What does that U-turn mean? We are moving this in one particular direction, but then we make a U-turn and we're going in the opposite direction. So it's a changing of our thinking. It's a changing of our choices. It's a changing of our decisions. It's a changing of our lifestyle. So repentance means changing, making a shift. Okay, even to the completely opposite, if that's what God's way is all about. So a prayer of repentance simply means we are saying sorry to God for our ways, for, you know, our manner of life. And we're saying, God, I want to change. I want to live according to your word, according to your purposes. So the Bible encourages us to repent. Whenever we discover that maybe we are a believer now and we are already in Christ, but how many of us can, confirm with me that we do make mistakes? Mistakes happen, right? From day to day, something small, something unintentional, but maybe even something intentional we do. And we feel sorry that, oh, I should not have done it. I should not have said it. I should have behaved better. What do we do? when these mistakes happen? The Bible says we need to come before God and we need to repent. Okay, and Peter, when he speaks to the people around in Acts chapter 3, he says, repent and times of refreshing will come. So when we repent, God will begin to minister to us in a fresh, new way. There is a passage that tells us what happens when we confess our sins. Okay, that God is able to forgive us. 1 John chapter 1 verses 7 through 9. 1 John chapter 1 verses 7 through 9. Who would like to read this passage? Anyone? Another person?
But if we walk in the light as He is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, His Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sin, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Very nice. So here we observe that there is a need for us in our lives to admit anything that may be wrong. So Apostle John says, if we say that we don't have any sin in us, it's like we are pretending. We're even lying sometimes when we say, ah, nothing is wrong with me, everything is okay, I'm right all the time. It doesn't happen. So when we discover or we identify that something is wrong, we must immediately repent. Which means we must say in the prayer of confession, it means we are telling God, God, I'm so sorry, this happened, I did this, I made a mistake, I really want you to forgive me. And what does that verse say? Verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful to forgive us. Right? Then God will forgive us when we repent, when we confess. But if we say, imagine we make a mistake, and we don't admit it, right? That's not correct, because the psalmist says that, you know, I did not confess my sin to you, and it's like rottenness in my bones, meaning I kept it within myself and I'm pretending that everything is okay, but everything is not okay. You know, an attitude like that will really destroy us. But when we are relating with God, a very important attitude is to be honest. Be honest with God, because God already knows. We can't fool God. He knows what is right. He knows what is wrong. He knows what we have done. So God knows that we have made a mistake, but when the Holy Spirit convicts us of that mistake, what should we do? Repent, confess to God and say, God, forgive me. What does verse 9 say? He will forgive us our sins. The blood of Jesus will wash us clean if we confess our sins. Okay, so this is something that we must practice throughout our lives. No matter how strong we become in God, to be honest with God and say, yeah, everybody makes mistakes. We may even grow in the Lord and become so strong in Him, but sometimes we make mistakes. Sometimes we say things we shouldn't have said. But we must be honest and quick to repent and say, God, I'm so sorry. I shouldn't have done it like that. And always maintain that, you know, like a childlike heart where whenever we come to God and we confess, God says, hey, I'll wash you. I've already shed my blood for the washing of your sins, my valuable blood, my precious blood. God will cleanse us, right? And once again, we can get up and we can make the right choices instead of the wrong choices and continue to live for God. And that's a very important lesson for all of us. And repentance. Because when we say repentance, usually we only think of the time of salvation. We accepted Christ, we repented, it's over. But as we journey through life, to be very honest and respond to the convictions of the Holy Spirit and to change every day, we say, okay, God, yes, that was wrong. Now I'm going to do what is right. That's the way to build our Christian life and our even our prayer walk with the Lord, with the help of the prayer of repentance and confession. The next prayer here is the prayer of unburdening. So the unburdening prayer simply means sharing our hearts. Okay, so if you have, you know, like if you're very close with your family members or you have a very close friend, what happens to us whenever we meet them, right? We tell everything. Sometimes, you know, it may even go on for hours because we're sharing, you know, what happened, this happened, that happened, I felt like this, they said this and I said that. So we are just sharing our hearts. And it's a part of our relationship, you know, with maybe our parents or our siblings or a close friend. But even with God, God says, you come, you share your heart with me. So there can be times in our prayer where it may not be asking God for anything, or it may not even be repentance. It may not even be, you know, like some prayer of agreement, but you're just sharing with God. And you're just... In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, it says, cast your cares upon the Lord, meaning your concerns. You're just sharing all your concerns with the Lord. But the Bible says you can do that. Cast your cares upon the Lord because He cares for you. Whether somebody else will listen to you or not, God will listen to us. Isn't that a privilege? Amen. So we can go to God and we can just pour out our hearts and we say, God, I know you will listen to me. Even if it is for many hours, I'm going to be in your presence and just share. Pour out your heart before the Lord. That is also a kind of prayer which we call as the prayer of unburdening. And especially in difficult times, right? It's so helpful because we may not even be speaking in a structured way or an organized way. We are so confused. But thank God, He's so patient, so kind, so gracious with us, where He says, you come, you share, you pour out your heart, and I will listen to you. So we can practice even the prayer of unburdening. Okay, let's go on. I'll move on to the next kind of prayer here, which is the prayer of faith for healing. I don't think I should be rushing. It doesn't make sense. Okay, sorry. I'll just stop for today. We can maybe discuss a couple of things and then close in prayer. Only 3 minutes left. So there's a question in the chat. We're blessed, he's saying, when we desire and ask for spiritual gifts, can demons stop the spiritual gifts from God? Can demons stop the spiritual gifts from God? So, Blessy, the things that stop the operation of spiritual gifts is mainly unbelief. Demons are also not such a big problem. Unbelief is the biggest problem that stops us from operating in spiritual gifts. Okay? Because, wait, I'll just see if I can get you that. Okay, Romans 12. According to the grace. Okay, verse 6, Romans 12, verse 6, it says, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. So the emphasis that I want to bring here is, prophecy is a gift, right? How is Paul asking us to operate in the gift? He says, gift in proportion to our faith. So if there is faith, if there is more faith, you operate more. Same thing applies all the gifts, whether it is tongues or anything else. When we have faith, it works. When we lack faith, it won't work. So demons as such is a very secondary problem. Faith is the big problem. Okay. Unbelief rather. Unbelief is the big problem. Okay, great. Yes, anything else or we can close? Okay, fine. Let's just close with a word of prayer. I'll pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. Lord, thank you that your word is the water that washes us, oh God. And Father, we pray that each one of us will encounter you in a fresh way, strengthen our walk with you. Lord, we ask, oh God, that our prayer lives will become stronger, and Lord, that we will have a deeper connect with you. We are grateful, God, for everything that we are learning. Holy Spirit, we ask that you will continue to minister to each one of our hearts. We bless you. We honor you. We give you all the praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, thank you, everyone. I will post your assignments shortly. So just a note of caution or alerting you. So be ready. Assignments around the corner. Thank you. Bye for now.